立法會主席。The
President.
I would like to remind members, in accordance with the rules or procedures, members may only speak when called upon by me, and during the meeting, you have to act with decorum, and you should not use offensive or insulting language.
Question number
five. Point of order, Mr. Chen Chi-chin. Are we going to have a break after Q5? After Q5 is completed, I'll make an announcement. Mr. James To, it's been almost 6 months since the eruption of the disturbances arising from the opposition to the proposed legislative amendments. It has been reported that the acts of some police officers in handling public events have aroused public concern. Such acts include firing a number of tear gas rounds at universities and residential areas, shooting and injuring demonstrators under unwarranted situations, running a motorcycle into demonstrators, firing sponge rounds at journalists who were performing news covering work, spraying pepper spray at the face of bystanders and journalists at close range, cursing and arresting bystanders, arresting district council members who were at the scene of a demonstration observing the situation, and arresting members of public who donated supplies such as clothes and food. In this connection, would the government inform this council, one, of the details of the cases in which police officers fire live ammunition and rubber bullets, respectively, during public events since June this year, including the number of police officers involved, the number of bullets fired, the resulting casualties, with a breakdown by demonstrators, journalists, and members of the public, the body parts of the injured to which injuries were sustained, as well as the current number of persons who are now hospitalized. Two, of the respective numbers of police officers who were subject to complaints, warnings, suspension from frontline duties, orders to take leave, criminal investigations and punishments as a result of breaches or suspected breaches of police general orders or the guidelines on the use of force since June this year. Whether the newly appointed Commissioner of Police will order police officers to exercise restraint when performing duties, impose severe punishment on the public or on the police officers breaching the relevant requirements, and refer cases of police officers being alleged of having committed criminal offences to the Department of Justice for consideration of whether or not prosecution should be instituted. And three, as the international expert panel set up by the Independent Police Complaints Council a few months ago has indicated earlier this month that with a shortfall in IPCC powers and its independent investigative capability, it is necessary to enhance IPCC's capability to gather evidence before IPCC can complete its interim report. And it has also proposed that a more comprehensive inquiry should be conducted by an independent body as a next step. Whether the government will consider the panel's proposal and make public fully the interim report, Secretary for Security. President, members of the public enjoy the freedoms of expression, speech and assembly, but they must exercise them peacefully and lawfully. The police have a statutory duty to maintain public safety and public order. When unlawful acts take place, the police must take appropriate action to restore peace in the community. The police will not need to use any force. If members of public could express their views in a peaceful and rational manner, since the 9th of June this year, more than 900 protests, processions, and public assemblies have been staged in Hong Kong, and many of them ended up in serious violence and illegal acts. In the past 5 months or so, there were numerous severely illegal acts, including wantonly blocking roads, paralyzing traffic, hurling petrol bombs and setting fires at various locations, throwing bricks, intentionally vandalizing and burning shops and railway facilities, frequently assaulting others holding different opinion, seriously wounding others and violently attacking police officers, etc. recently a large number of persons occupy university campuses where they cause extensive damages, stole dangerous chemicals, and manufacture petrol bombs on campus, targeting the police on a large scale. For responding to and curbing violent acts, police officers have to deploy appropriate force to control the scene and bring rioters to justice so as to restore public safety and order. While using force and making arrests, the police must act according to the law, taking account of the situation at the scene and in an appropriate manner. They must also comply with relevant internal guidelines. The references to the act of police officers in the reports mentioned in the preamble of Honorable To's question have not taken into consideration the full account of events and have made unfair accusations. I do not agree to these references, which will not fully reflect the facts. In fact, serious violence and illegal acts in the past months have already resulted in the death of an innocent member of the public who was killed by a brick hurled at him. From the 9th of June to the 26th of November this year, more than 2,600 persons were injured and sought medical consultation or received treatment at public hospitals, including a victim seriously burned by a rioter who ignited flammable liquids on him. More than 470 of the injured persons were police officers who suffered from knife wounds, corrosive liquid burns, fractures, severe burns, wounds inflicted by arrows, etc. My reply to the various parts of the question is as follows. 1. The police have strict guidelines on the use of force. To restore public peace, the police will need to deploy appropriate force against violent illegal acts based on actual needs. Police officers will, as far as circumstances permit, give verbal warning before using force and give the person so warned the opportunity to obey police orders where practicable. Generally speaking, weapons used are non-lethal equipment such as rubber bullets. As for the use of live ammunition, the police have very stringent rules and guidelines. A police officer may use live ammunition to protect any person, including himself or herself, from the threat of death or serious injuries. From the 9th of June to the 12th of November this year, the police used about 4,800 rubber bullets in response to violent acts of protesters in various public order events. Up to the 18th of November, the police fired a total of 19 live shots in 13 incidents. 9 incidents involved 1 live shot, 2 incidents involved 2 live shots, and 2 incidents involved 3 live shots. All of the police officers concerned were protecting themselves and all others at the scene from immediate threat of death or potential threat of death in case the rioters were not stopped. In 3 incidents, the suspects were hit. A suspect was hit near the left shoulder in Chuman on the 1st of October, another hit in the left thigh in Yunnan on the 4th of November, and yet another hit in the right abdomen on the 11th of November in Saiwan Hall. The 3 injured persons have been discharged from hospital. The police do not maintain the other information requested in the question. 2. The police do not tolerate any breach of law or offence against discipline by police officers. If individual police officers are suspected of having done so, the police will make investigation and follow up actively in accordance with the established mechanism in a fair and impartial manner. As at the 25th of November, the complaints against police office, CAPO, received 1,261 complaints in relation to major public order events since the 9th of June. CAPO has set up a dedicated team of 26 members to follow up these cases. The complaints concerned are still under investigation. CAPO does not maintain the breakdown requested in this question. Being a professional force, the police have all along placed emphasis on discipline and acting in accordance with the law. The new Commissioner of Police will firmly uphold these principles. 3. The Independent Police Complaints Council, IPCC,
operates independently under the Independent Police Complaints Council Ordinance CAP 604 to perform its statutory functions, which include observing, monitoring and reviewing the handling and investigation of reportable complaints by CAPO and making recommendations on the handling and investigation of complaints. IPCC may also identify any fault or deficiency in any practice or procedure adopted by the police that has led to or might lead to reportable complaints, and to make recommendations to the police or the chief executive. In response to public concerns regarding law enforcement actions by the police in major public order events, IPCC has established a special task force and an international expert panel, IEP, to proactively study major public order events held since the 9th of June in Hong Kong and the corresponding actions taken by the police, and to announce the progress by phases. In early November this year, an IEP member took his own initiative to upload a document named Progress Report onto his personal social media account. IPCC made a statement via a press release on the 10th of November and indicated that the document had not been seen or deliberated by IPCC members. IPCC expressed disappointment about the sharing. IPCC stated that it was fully aware of the limitations of its legal powers and resources as mentioned in the document and have been continually working to enhance its resources. IPCC stated that it was committed to submitting the preliminary report of the study with sufficient facts and preliminary conclusions to the CE and publish the details within the original time frame, i.e. early 2020. The report to be submitted by IPCC to the CE will be made available to the public for examination in detail. As a matter of fact, IPCC has rich experience in handling complaints against the police. We need to give IPCC the necessary time and room so that it can focus on completing its study. The government will cooperate fully with IPCC to facilitate its work. At present, IPCC should be allowed to perform its statutory functions under the prevailing mechanism. Upon release of the report, the government will carefully consider the recommendations and follow up as appropriate. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. James To, President, most Hong Kongers are reasonable, are rational. They can see the truth for themselves. If the police have not been acting so unreasonably, people wouldn't be so angry. And in the DC election, the result is a landslide. If the government has been doing what it has claimed to be doing, people wouldn't have reacted in such a way. So let me put this question again. Firing unarmed civilians at close range with live rounds and beating up an arrested person under control at the head and at other parts of the body. A police officer drove a motorcycle into a crowd and firing at a tourist at her back, firing tear gas, causing a stampede, and the first aider was driven away, and then a banker was verbally abused by police officers in Central. I want to ask the secretary that are these acts allowed by the police? Do you agree that these are outrageous behavior? If the police is really very stringent in enforcing the law and its own rules, I would like to ask whether there's been any one single officer who has been put under investigation or suspended from duties or prosecuted? Secretary for Security, in answering the question put by Mr. James To, I've already said that many accusations reported in the building may not reflect the full account of the incidents. We may see a particular part of the scene. We have to know
whether what happened before that and what happened after that, it would be biased if we just look at one particular part of the incident. And I've said that after conducting fair and impartial investigations, if the result tells us that a certain incident should be dealt with in a certain way, we'll follow the complaint investigation mechanism and take action to follow up. As I've said, the police attach importance to discipline and must act in accordance with the law, and a new commissioner would uphold such principles. So all these incidents will be investigated fairly and impartially, and then when we find out the truth, we'll take appropriate action. But in the same reply, I've also pointed out that all cases are under investigation. We haven't reached the stage where we can make the conclusions and submit the reports. So in the meantime, we haven't taken any action because these cases are being investigated. But we also take action where warranted. For example, in the North District Hospital, when the government realized, the police realized that some police officers took some action which they shouldn't have, these officers were suspended from duty immediately, and then legal proceedings, criminal proceedings followed. So it shows that the police will take appropriate action and follow up the cases very diligently. What about those examples that I've just quoted? Has those cases resulted in any one single case of suspension of duty? I think the question has been answered. I think I have answered the question. Secretary, I hope you won't mind that in the past few months, people with the right mind know that the police have been making great contributions in stopping the violence. Please don't mind those unfair criticism. I think the police are using the lowest level of force in those cases, and compared with overseas police forces, we are doing much better. Please don't give any message of connivance or when it comes to protection gear of police officers. There is a need to make improvements. And now the Hong Kong Human Rights and Democracy Act has been passed by the U.S. Congress. And now they want to stop the supply of tear gas and other equipment to Hong Kong. We have to thank Mr. Joshua Wong for that. So, members, please keep quiet. How can you ensure the supplies of equipment to the police? And what about vehicles? The armored vehicles of the police are very old. Do you have any plan to replace them with new ones? I'm just talking about equipment and protection gear. When are you going to renew and upgrade them, Secretary? Thank you, President. The police have a duty to provide adequate and effective protection gear to police officers so that they can discharge their duties. On the question of procurement, the police would pay attention to likely sources of protection gear that we may procure for our police officers from different countries. We have to follow the government's procurement arrangement. At present, the procurement is done globally. We can procure the necessary equipment and gear from any place. On police vehicles, we'll look at operational needs. I understand the police has got a dedicated team to review all the equipment needed in their operation, such as gear, vehicles, protection gear and equipment. And different tools needed, and they will also make a reference to overseas practice concerning the effectiveness of different equipment, and they will also listen to frontline officers about the difficulties they encounter, so that we can provide adequate and effective protection gear to make sure that they can discharge their duties effectively and their safety protected. Mr. Wai-keung, this question is about the legal enforcement action taken by police officers. I think the major concern now is the PolyU case. The president of the PolyU has just announced that the search conducted by the PolyU management has failed to find anyone who is still staying behind in the campus, and they would like the cordon be withdrawn. I hope the secretary can explain or can respond to this request from PolyU proactively. Would you withdraw the officers? Half an hour ago, the management of PolyU came out to put forward this request. Would you respond to this request actively? Secretary? I think the government and the university management all want this to be resolved orderly and peacefully. The police have been flexible in its deployment to deal with those who are still remaining in the campus. A day before yesterday, the police announced the setting up of a safety team to persuade those who have remained to leave. And they will also look at the medical needs of these people, and a suitable arrangement will be made for them, and these people will not be arrested immediately. We share the objective of the university, and I know different people, both from the university and from other organizations, have been trying to achieve this and persuade these people to leave. We will take up the matter with the university to chart the way forward and plan for the next steps. The purpose is to ensure that everyone who remain there can leave peacefully. A very simple question. Can you be more proactive today? Make a more proactive arrangement. Could you respond to the university's request today? I think that's not the same question. But anyway, Secretary, anything to add? As I've said, we hope this matter can be resolved in a safe manner, and to ensure that those who need medical care will be taken care of. For those who are in the campus, they are advised to leave as early as possible. I will certainly seek to get an early resolution of the matter, and I hope that everyone can leave the campus peacefully. Meeting is now suspended.